Be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. I'd like you to begin to plead the blood of Jesus Christ over your life right now. Plead the blood of Jesus over your environment. Let's submit to the ministry of the Holy Spirit this hour. And let's begin to receive grace to be awake. Remember, it is the midnight hour. It is the time of the highest spiritual activity. There's a battle that is raging, but we are fighting from the place of victory. Your field marshal, the captain of your salvation, is already there. All that we need is to cooperate with him, to tell him we depend upon him. We don't want to fall asleep while he's talking to us. Receive grace this morning. Lord, we Amen. Come, but we recognize that we are the midnight hour. We recognize that we're in the battlefield. We cannot afford to sleep in the battlefield. We ask you for grace. We ask you for mercy. We ask you, God, that you will never be one of us. God, that we'll be awake, that there will be no extinction, that the enemy will not steal from us. God, the one that gives strength, God, receive strength from you. Receive help. Understand it's not by power. Understand it's not by might, but by your spirit. We depend upon you. Blessed be your name. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray with thanksgiving in our hearts. Amen. All right. I want to once again greet you and welcome you in the name of our Lord Jesus in this year of the manifestation of the name of the Lord Most High. Who is ruling in our life? Who is ruling in our family, in the church, in our city, in our nation and nations of the world, including Israel, and of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end. We are all witnesses, even if you have not acknowledged and testified in your own personal capacity. Looking at the world at large globally, you see this prophetic word fulfilling. God is showing himself mighty, that is, the one that rules in the kingdom of men. He's demonstrated that in Israel. He demonstrated it in the nation of America. He demonstrated it in several areas. If you look into the prophetic world, one of the things the Lord said, that he was going to shake things and expose the source and the foundation of things that we seem not to have understood. One of the global events was the exposure of the altar of Ishtar in America that was publicly denounced, even all of them this year. For many years, believers have not been able to identify the difference between the goddess Ishtar and Pascha, Passover. So the many believers have celebrated Easter for years, but this year it was clear because the two celebrations came at a different time. And for the first time, some Christians were able to question what they had been celebrating over the years. That's part of God's word coming to pass. And we see the word of God, come to pass several areas in our personal life, in the church, in our city. In this year, we will all be witnesses that the global church was highly strengthened because of what God did in America, in other parts of the world. The church is not hiding, as the case have always been for years. And this is the beginning of the glory of the church, fulfilling of God's word, according to Micah chapter number 2. That in the last day, the mountain of the house of Micah chapter 4, rather, and Isaiah chapter 2, that the mountain of the house of God shall be exalted above the hills. They will not be in the hiding. Nations and multitude will stream to say, let's go to the house of the God of Jacob, for he will show us the way. For out of Jerusalem shall come out the law. This is the beginning of the manifestation of the fulfillment of the glory of the church. And the reason is, whenever the Lord is enthroned, he will draw all men to himself. So when he begins to take a position as the Most High, obviously, it is his body. When a man is standing up, his head is high, the body cannot be, you know, hidden on the dust. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And we've been studying on the, you know, the reality of who we are because of our union with Christ. That's been our Genesis, January. And we, at this point, we've come to what we have because of our union with Christ. And the last thing we're studying, we're trying to tidy up, is the truth that we have an inheritance. And this inheritance is not like the one that we know, the inheritance that we had by default because of being Gentiles. And the summary of our inheritance being Gentile is we inherited vanity. Jeremiah had to prophetically spoke thousands of years ago that a time will come when we as the Gentile will approach the Lord to say, oh Lord, my God, you know, he said, the Gentiles will come to you and say, we have inherited vanity. Our fathers have transmitted vanity. And what was the vanity? Idolatry. That's the summary of our inheritance. No matter even the, maybe the few percent that inherited, you know, let's say a throne, even that throne is a throne of iniquity. Say throne of iniquity, a throne of incest, a throne of witchcraft, a throne of bloodshed. Even when we inherited, even the issue of money, it is many times stressed the secret of the money. You discover again, it is rooted in idolatry. It is rooted in witchcraft. It is rooted in, you know, occultism. And that's the summary of our inheritance. No matter how far you try to look into it, that's exactly the summary of the inheritance of the Gentiles. And when we say Gentile, talking about everyone, including the America, everybody else that is not a Jew. Now, on the other hand, when you look into what the Jewish people inherited, you will understand strictly, you know, that the Abraham made sure that is, he was completely separated from his foundation. It's interesting, you know, when I look into the book of Joel, to the extent that he went. Can you imagine? Look at Joel, I mean, Hebrew chapter number 11. And then, because we're going to take off from there right away, in Hebrew chapter number 11, verse number 8, look at the Bible said, it was by faith that Abraham obeyed when God called him to leave his home, to go to another land that he would give him as an inheritance. I hope you're seeing that. He went without knowing where he was going. Remember the journey. He was to receive an inheritance. God had to call him to separate. He called him out. He had to decamp from not just his personal life of sin, but he had to decamp from his home, from his father's land, from his nation, cut off to a place that the Lord will give him as an inheritance. Now, look at what happened when he arrived there. He also understood that the place that he's going, that the people there, you know, their inheritance is not different from the inheritance, you know, of where he's coming from. Look at what he did. And even when he reached the land God promised him, he lived there by faith. For he was like a foreigner living in tents. Did you see that? He was living in tents. He refused to live in a structured house. Why? because he didn't want to get polluted by the foundation again. He was living in tents, and so did Isaac. I was shocked when I see that. And when I went to check out this truth, whether Isaac was living in tents, that was so true. He was living in a tent. You can check it out yourself. When you get to, in chapter 25 of Genesis, the Bible says when Isaac took Rebekah to his tent, he was living in tent. And even Jacob, to whom God gave the same promise, can you see that? That's why Abraham did this, because he was confidently looking forward for a city with eternal foundation. Did you see that? A city designed and built by God himself. He's looking for a city that with a different foundation, because they found his own foundation was idolatrous. The one that he came into was idolatrous. He was not ready for that city. He was looking for a city that the Lord himself is the foundation. Can you see that? And what was that city eventually? Jerusalem was founded. The Lord had to give a design how to build the altar in Jerusalem, a city whose founder is the Lord. Founder and builder is the Lord. Can you see? These things are serious matters. So, men and brethren, we try to see the content of our inheritance in Christ. We saw that we inherited salvation. We inherited nature, because according to the order of inheritance, you begin by inheriting the nature of your parents before you can inherit their property, their asset. So the first thing you inherit is their nature, their DNA. You inherit whatever is in their bloodline. And that is exactly what happened. Our inheritance in Christ, a blessed inheritance, which is different from the cursed inheritance, is an eternal inheritance. It's an inheritance that is all-compassing. It covers every dimension of life. It's first of all spiritual. Then it is physical on every area. It is mentally. On every area is an all-encompassing inheritance. And then ultimately, we inherited the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of heaven is our inheritance. We inherited a name that's above every name, a name that have authority in all realms. Whether spiritual realm, physical realm, whatever realm, is that at the mention of that name, every knee will bow, the name of Jesus in heaven and on earth, beneath the earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of the Father. We inherited, we inherited the land. The land is a part of our inheritance. The earth is part of our inheritance. So this morning we are saying, now why do we need, what impact with the revelation? Because we need a revelation of what we have inherited because of our union with Christ. We have just mentioned them last week, but the truth is that we need a revelation of what this inheritance is. We part of our inheritance is dominion. Dominion. Authority, power. We have authority. We have dominion. Authority over everything that God created. Authority over unclean spirit. The only authority that we are restrained from having is dominion over human spirit. Anyone that dominates human spirit practices witchcraft. We have authority over sickness and diseases. We have authority over nature, everything that is created, the storm, the rain, the thunder, whatever. We have authority over every plant and everything that swims in the water. We have authority. We have received it. It's part of our inheritance. We receive that throne. We, more than any other thing, we receive a blessing, the force of God's blessing that transforms, the curse and then turn it around. And then, but the truth is, this is our inheritance. We say the first thing that is required for the journey into our inheritance to begin is that we must, of a necessity, be disconnected from our inheritance as Gentiles, our old inheritance, our family inheritance, the covenants, the altars, the lifestyle, the bloodline matters. We must, if you don't cut off from it, if you don't zoom in to make sure that you are disconnected from your people in all the negative sense, the way they think, the way they speak, the language, the things they believe that are contrary to the word of God, the things they value, their traditions, their cultures that are contrary to them. If you do not disconnect from them and remain disconnected, watching to make sure that you are not entangled. If you don't, then it's not possible to think about being able to, become, engrafted into the family, because we are adopted into the family. And for the legal transaction to become, a reality, there must, of a necessity, you must come as a branch, not as a tree. You must be cut off. You must come as a trimmed branch with a shape to be grafted into the roots, which is Christ. So we said that revelation, we bring it of the what our inheritance is. We bring a turnaround in every aspect of our life. Our inheritance in Christ should have a huge positive impact on us. As we know, before we came to Christ, our negative, a foundation and inheritance had a terrible impact in our life. The negative inheritance we had a terrible impact in our life. And now God wants us to see that the positive light is stronger than darkness. So the new inheritance should bring a revolution. We should turn everything away, should undermine the power of all the negative, the curses you inherited, the evil covenant you inherited, the bloodline matters through what Jesus did, which you have come to be one with him when you have denounced all these things and then walk in the light daily. The inheritance you have is no longer a cursed one, but blessing. You have the living God. You have the power, that transform everything, that turns the barren to be fruitful, that turns the poor to be rich, that turns the failed one as failure, the one that is, in the dunghill to sit with prince. That is what our inheritance is. And today we want to see what's the price from our part. Jesus paid the price on the cross of Calvary in order to bring us such, everlasting inheritance, reserved for us, the fullness of it in heaven. What on our side, what is the price? We have seen who is eligible. We said, oh, everyone that is born of God is eligible, irrespective of whether you are male or female. Unlike the human inheritance that is reserved mainly for the sons, especially the first son. But then in this kingdom, everyone is eligible. Whether you are, doesn't matter whether you are male or female, doesn't matter whether you, where you're coming from. It doesn't matter your color of your skin. We are all children of God and we are eligible to the inheritance. Now, but we need to see, so what is the price from our own side? Because we see that it doesn't automatically become ours, not even in the natural. The inheritance doesn't automatically fall to the sons, you see? And so we need to see the price. Everything that God has promised you, there's a part that we need to play. And if we do not play that part, God is not obliged. God is a God of principle. He's not moved by emotion. whatever thing you are doing, he's looking to see whether you have met the condition. So the first thing that is must be, and let's reemphasize that, is that you must be born again into the family of God. For only legitimate children are entitled to inheritance. And that's the same thing that John was saying in John 3:3. Except a man be born again, he cannot, inherit the kingdom of God. You see? So you can't inherit the kingdom if you are not born again. And then Ephesians chapter 1, verse number 11 said, made a similar statement. Made a similar statement. I hope we are together. You are awake, and the rule of the game is that you will cooperate. You will read with us. You will make your comments on the listing. You will show that you are awake. You get committed. All right. Ephesians chapter number 1, verse 11. Furthermore, because of Christ, we have received an inheritance from God. For he chose us from the beginning, and all things happened just as he decided long ago. You see the point? We are saying, and again, in John 1:12, thank you very much. You are awake, my dear. John 1:12 said, as men that receive him. If you remember verse 11, let somebody read verse 11, 1, verse chapter 1 of John 11 and 12, and see how we came to become part of this whole thing. Hurry up, please. And then another person, take up Romans chapter 8, verse number 14. And then yet another person. Yes, another person. Galatians chapter 4, 1 to 7. And then, of course, another person. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1, and then 12 to 14. And the last person, Genesis 17, 1 to 2. Okay. So which one did you see? Please hurry up and read. You are
Romans
not alone.
8:14.
Yes. Read.
Because those who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God.
Exactly. Now I want you to note, okay, Galatians 4, 1 to 7, someone to help us. Okay, you are wasting time. Think of this in this way from verse 1 of Galatians. If a father dies and leaves a great wealth for his young children, those children are not much better than that of them slave until they grow up. Can you see that? Even though they actually own everything their father had, they had to obey their guardian until they reach whatever age their father said. And that's the way it was with us before Christ came. We are slaves to spiritual powers of this world. But when the right time came, God sent his son, born of a woman, subject to the law. God sent him to buy our freedom for us. We were slaves to the law so that he could adopt us as his very children. Can you see that? And because you Gentiles have been his children, God has sent his son, the spirit of his son, into your heart. And now you can call God their father. Now you are no longer slave, but God's own child. And since you are God's own child, everything he has belongs to you. Before you Gentile know God, you were slave to so-called God that do not exist. And now that you have found God, or should I say now that God has found you, why do you need to want to go back again and become slave once more to the weak and useless spiritual powers? Now, what are we trying to bring across to you? Can you see the process? He said the heir, as long as he's a child, is not different from a slave until the time that he is grown up. So we are trying to bring across to you, he said, those who are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. We come into faith as a child of God, as children of God. But we don't, we, yes, the inheritance is us legally, but we experientially, we are not different from people that are slaves, people that are not children of God until we mature. So inheritance does not come to you just because you are a child of God. Inheritance comes only to matured, sons, people that have matured. And it is very important. And your maturity is not just something you say. If those of us that have children, you know what happens. Sometimes your child will say, "Mommy, I have grown. Can't you see I have grown? You know, I'm no longer a baby." And then you will laugh and say, "Yes, my child, you are not a baby." The fact that you said I've grown is still a sign that you're a baby, but they don't know. They tell you, "Look, I'm grown. I'm no longer a child." So it doesn't happen that way by just saying it. There are things that, mark you, whether you are a child or you're a baby or you are now grown. There are characteristics of a matured person. So we are saying inheritance, all this thing we talk about, dominion, power, authority, in inheriting the name, using the name of Jesus Christ to do exploits, inheriting the earth, the kingdom, nations, these things that we have just talked about, your inheritance, that blessing, to walk in the reality of this blessing, to walk in the reality of your health, to walk in the reality of your wealth, to walk in the reality of dominion, where the powers of hell respond to you. The Bible is saying it doesn't happen at the baby level. It doesn't happen at a child level. So being born of God alone does not make you to inherit it. Just like none of us will give, your car key, your Mercedes Benz to your 5 years old child and say, because he's your son, he's born of you, you give him and say, he's asking you, "I need a car." What you do is to give him a toy car. He's not yet of that age to be able to drive your Mercedes. Neither will you give him your estate at that hour, at that moment, because he's not yet. And the truth is that I want you to know that it's not really even a function of age per se. Do you know there are people that are up to 40 years, they are still living in their parents' house, but because of the way they are behaving, you cannot entrust, take your car and give to him, even though he is 35 years. But you don't trust him. You can't trust him with anything. If he's a drug addict or alcoholic, you cannot take your estate and give to him, because you know what will happen. Within 1 week, it will break down. The whole thing will vanish. Though even though he's 40 years, but you can't. You can't still trust it. You still hide everything that you have. Meanwhile, you have a son that is 40 years. You can't trust him with your things. I want you to understand it in that dimension. Because one of the things that was usually the problem, we say to God, "What are you waiting for? Look at how old I am. I'm getting to 40, but you're not even bringing a husband to me. I'm still not married. I'm getting to 45. You still haven't given me X, Y, Z. It's supposed to be, I'm serving you." And God is looking at you and say, "I hear you. You are talking about your physical age, but I'm looking at your life and discover that you are still operating like a baby, spiritual baby. Yes, physically you are 50 years, but you're operating like 3 months baby spiritually. And that's why I cannot entrust you. I'm not looking at your physical age. Doesn't make sense. You may be physically equal to a father, but you are still a baby father. So I can't trust you with huge responsibility. It will become a disaster, because I don't want you to be destroyed. At least you are still a child, a baby that belongs to me. I don't want to trust you with millions, because I know you can't handle it, because you are still operating as a baby." So we must understand these dynamics and see. Sometimes we think God is delaying. He's not delaying, he's waiting for maturity. Now look at Genesis 17, verse 1 to 2, so that you appreciate what God is saying. In Genesis 17, verse 1. When Abraham was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him and said, I am God Almighty, serve me and live a blameless life, and I will make a covenant with you by which all the that I will guarantee to make you into a mighty nation. Remember, he gave him this promise 24 years ago. Now let me read King James so that you understand. And when Abraham was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abraham and said unto him, I'm the Almighty God. Walk before me and be perfect. Walk before me and be perfect. Now that word perfect, I want you to note that that word perfect is the word mature. I prove it to you now. When Abraham was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him, I'm the Almighty God, walk before me, live habitually and be perfect, blameless, wholeheartedly, complete. Now, okay, and then King James Version, and I will confirm my covenant. I will, and I will make my covenant solemn place between me and you and multiply you. So I will confirm, look at that NIV. I will confirm my covenant between me and you. I've given you a covenant. I've given promise you an inheritance. But that promise I gave to you will only be confirmed when you walk before me and be mature. Let me prove to you that that's mature. Look at Hebrew chapter 6, verse number 1. Hurry up. Hebrew chapter 6, verse number 1. Look at that. So let us stop going over the basics of Christianity and again. Let's go up onto instead and become mature in our understanding. Surely we don't need to start all over with the importance of turning from evil deed and placing our faith in God. King James Version. Look at King James Version. Yes. Who is in King, with King James? Read. Admin, are you awake?
Therefore, let us move for the elementary teachings about Christ and be taken forward to maturity.
To maturity. Is that King James Version?
Oh, sorry, this is NIV. Sorry.
King James Version. Say, therefore, leaving the principle of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on to perfection. Not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith towards God. Can you see that? I'm trying to prove to you that what the Lord was talking, telling Abraham, is the same thing that he's telling us here in the New Testament. And what was the call? The call to maturity, operation, let my people grow. The Lord said to Abraham, when you read it, you said God gave a promise and only fulfilled it 25 years after. The question is, what was the Lord waiting for? Was the Lord waiting for 25 years to fulfill the promise? It was the, you say Abraham waited for 25 years. It was God that waited for 25 years. So the delay that we are experiencing in our life, it's not us waiting for God. We usually think it is us waiting for God. And we cry out to God and say, what is this thing? There shall be no more delay. I refuse delay. I break delay. God say, I hear. You break delay. But I'm waiting to see it break in the lifestyle you live, in the way you do things, in the way you approach me, in the way you live by the word. So God had to wait. In fact, God was becoming impatient. And he had to confront him and say, I'm the Lord Almighty, the God of all impossibility, the all-powerful God that gave you a promise, that can fulfill a promise. I'm waiting for you. Walk before me and be mature, and I will confirm what I said. And what he said to the father, he's saying to the children, every one of us that have come into Christ, believe in the finished work of Calvary, we are children of Abraham by faith. And the same thing that he's saying to our father, he's saying to us, walk before me and be matured. Spend your time growing up, walk in maturity. Instead of claiming and say, I'm mature, this is my entitlement. This is my time to claim this, to claim this, to claim this. Claiming it doesn't make it just becoming yours. There must be a corresponding lifestyle to show that you are equal to be able to handle such level of blessing that you are claiming. So it took 25 years for Abraham to become, develop what it takes to become the father of nation. And we saw what happened that after that chapter, after that chapter, the promise come to pass. What are the evidence? How do we know if we are maturing? How can we prove? How do we evaluate maturity? Because as we're hearing this, said, okay, what else? But there are certain evidence of maturity. Number one, we can know a mature person by what they eat. By what you eat, your food give you away. Look at Hebrews chapter 5, verse 12. Quickly, somebody help me. And then number two, the choice you make. Look at Hebrews chapter number 11, verse 24 to 27. Number three, your service. The service. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 to 2, and Exodus 23, 25, quickly. And then, of course, 2 Corinthians 5, 17 to 19. Which one did you see? Help me quickly and read. You are awake. Are you awake?
Hebrews 5, yes, verse 12.
Super fast.
I say Hebrew 5, 12. And then Hebrew 11, 24 to 27. And then Romans 12, 1 to 2, Exodus 23, 25, 2 Corinthians 7, 5, 17 to 19. Okay.
Hebrews 5, 12. In fact, though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you the elementary truths of God's word. All over again. You need milk, not solid food.
Read the next verse.
Anyone who lives in milk being still an infant is not acquainted with the teaching about righteousness. But solid food is for the mature, who by constant use have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil.
Mm-hmm. That's fine. Did you see what we said? Your food gives you away. Evidence you cannot mature a Christian by their food. He said, when you still need milk, what is milk? It's an already prepared one. It is liquid. It's a prepared, put in a bottle for the baby. The baby does not go to prepare his food. If you don't give the baby food, he will not eat. And when you prepare it, you must be selective. You don't just bring anything. You have to squash it. You have to be liquid enough. We suck it from the bottle. If it has a little grain there, it cannot chew it because it's a baby. Now, the Bible made it clear that if at the time we are supposed to be teachers, we still need the food and it has to be prepared. You see, prepared food. The devotion guide had to be one verse. A man of God had to prepare a verse. Expound it. That's what you read in the morning for your devotion. Say, I've just read devotion. Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. The man of God prepare it, a nice sermon for you, and that's what you eat. And that when you eat it, you say, I've eaten for the day. And then that's what you go off with. You cannot, study the Bible yourself. You cannot, pick up a reading guide and read the Bible and invest time to try to get food for yourself. So your food gives you away. As long as you depend just on what is prepared, the prepared food, you go to service, go to fellowship, And you just depend on what the verse that pastor preach. That's where you defend. Nothing. You go for the day. That is it. You don't even go back again to study, to take up that scripture, to study further, to say, Lord, what are you saying? I didn't understand it. I need what? How does this thing impact me? A baby doesn't go that extra mile. He just go, and you must make sure it has to be safe. You don't give a baby something that is not sweet. If it's not sweet, it's a problem. You have to be sweet, you know? Mm-hmm. They like, that's why the best thing they love, sweet, sweet. Mommy, sweet. Grandma, I want sweet. Sweet, that's what they want. You don't just give them anything that's not sweet. They are looking for sweet, you know? And that is exactly the way many Christians are living. They are looking for sweet sermons. They are looking for convenient sermons. They are looking for the one that is fine. That's why what happened? The day Jesus preached a certain sermon, the Bible said they proud, they went home. They said, no, this is a hard thing. We didn't come for this one. No, 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 no. So our food give us away. What do you feed on? So why you are claiming all the things you are claiming and getting offended at God that he didn't, he's not doing you this. You have been 20 years in the faith, but this one has not happened. The other one has not happened. He hasn't given you a wife, a husband. He hasn't been giving you a car, this and that and that. You are supposed to have, you know, people should have known that you're a child of God. And God is looking at you and saying, but you are still a baby. These things you are asking for, so I give it, you kill yourself. Because you are still a baby. You still need milk, not solid food. So solid food are those who, by reason of exercise, in other words, they practice. If you give, do you notice what happened? Even when you try to give a meat to your baby who doesn't have teeth, he swallows it instead of chewing. So he swallows, and you have to, again, you have to rush him to hospital to get it out because he doesn't chew. You see, who by reason of exercise, when the word of God is not practiced, when you hear it and you don't practice, you don't exercise, when you hear, part of the sign that you are mature is to practice. And they speak about that when the season of fasting, you practice fasting. You are practicing fasting. You hear that God healed. You practice to say, Lord, I hear that you healed. You know, by standing on your word, I want to stand. You are practicing. You are practicing. Eh? If you cannot, you know, believe God for headache to go, how then do you go to raise the dead? You have to believe God for headache first, and then headache go, before you start dealing with meningitis. But when you don't practice, how then will you have an experience? You remain in the level of baby, and inheritance are not for babies. Your father will wait. He know when you are mature, not by the things you say. You know, we have children when they grow. Say, Mommy, I've grown. Can't you see? You say, that's true. You grow. You'll be laughing in your heart. You know that it hasn't grown. All right. So we're talking about your food gives you away. Do you have a Bible study life? Do you have a prayer life? Do you apply the things you hear? Or just you park them there? Eh? Do you discriminate the things you hear? They prophesy to you, they tell you things, and the Lord say, and the Lord, do you discriminate? Because you don't know the scriptures anyway. They can tell you anything, and you just swallow. Like a child, you swallow something that is going to hurt you. You didn't chew, you didn't discriminate, you didn't dissect it. The Bible said the Berean Christians, when they had Paul, they went back to cross-check what Paul was telling them. It's scriptural. And the Bible said they were more noble than the people of Thessalonians. They were more nobility, character, virtue, character. They were more matured on their approach. They are not easily deceived. No matter what they see, they want to go and check whether what they are hearing, this thing that they are preaching, they are prophesying, is it in line with the word of God? So your food gives you away. Number two, Hebrew 11, 24 to 27. Please quickly read. You are wasting time, men and brethren. If you are still awake, show it.
Hebrews 11:24 to 27.
Yes.
It was by faith that Moses, when he grew up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose to share the oppression of God's people instead of enjoying the fleeting pleasures of sin. He thought it was
Yes.
better to suffer for the sake of Christ than to own the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking ahead to his own great reward. It was by
Praise
faith
God.
that Moses left the land of Egypt, not fearing the king's anger. He kept right on
That's
going
right.
because he kept his eyes
Yes,
on the invisible. He kept
thank
his
you
eyes
very
on
much.
the invisible.
Exactly. Now we are talking about another thing where you have to look again is the choices you make. The choices you make give you a way to show whether you are matured or you are still a baby. The Bible said it was by faith that Moses, he chose not to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose suffering instead of pleasure of sin. He chose suffering instead of the pleasure of sin. That you see, going this way, living this way of boyfriend, girlfriend, it is going to give me some things I need now, and choosing to follow Jesus Christ and suffer, it means I won't be having this enough money I used to have through this lifestyle. I rather suffer, even if I had to, degrade, even if I have to go to one room now, it's better for me to go into one room. Even if I have to walk now, it's better for me to just walk on my feet than having this car from this man. The choices you make. You see, Esau choose, he said, give me, I'm not interested, better it what? I'm dying now, I need it now. I better have this phone now. I better have this job now. Even if he's sleeping with the manager, you know? So the choices we make, the choices we make, the sacrifice that we are ready to make, that yes, even though this salary here is not not big as this one here, but this one will allow me to serve God the way I want. I'd rather go for this lesser salary and serve God the way there's an opportunity to serve God, to expand the kingdom of God, than this one that I will have to even work on Sunday. Even though it's a big salary, I'd rather take a smaller salary and be pleasing to God than a big salary. The choices we make is going to determine whether you are matured or not. The Bible says he was ready to suffer, to come to the level of a slave, than to answer the prince of Egypt for a while, because he's looking beyond. Yes, these people are slaves now, but they will not be slaves forever. These people are on the throne now, but they will not be on the throne forever. The Bible said he make a decision, even to leave Egypt, because he was looking beyond the natural, looking at God of recompense that is going to reward him for such sacrifice that we make. We said your daily sacrifice, it will show whether you have matured or not. So we are saying the quality of choice you make reveals your maturity. You are matured when you could choose right and reject the wrong. You are matured. You begin to show maturity when you choose right, and reject the wrong. You choose, the pleasure instead of the pleasure of sin. So when you make such choice, your choice gives you away. What kind of choice do you make? What's the basis for the choice you make? Is it about the things you're going to get? Is it about your pleasure? Is it about your interest? Or about what God wants? Or about the kingdom of God? Or about how the kingdom of God will be expounded? That way is going to show whether you are mature or not. The next thing, read for me, Romans chapter 12, verse number 1 to 2, Exodus 23, verse 25. Quickly. You see, our time, we have not even gone halfway. You are wasting time getting scriptures.
Romans 12,
1 to
1
2,
and
Exodus 23, 25.
So, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you. Let them be
Amen.
A living and holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him. Don't copy
Amen.
the behavior and the customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. And then you will learn
Yes.
to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect.
Thank you very much. Exodus 23:25. And you must serve only the Lord your God. If you do, he will bless you with food and water and keep you healthy. There will be no miscarriage or infertility among you, among your people, and I'll give you long, full life. Did you see that? And of course, 2 Corinthians 5:17, if any man is in Christ, what it means that if those who become Christian become new persons, they are no longer same anymore. For the old life gone, a new life has begun. All this newness of life is from God, who brought us back to himself through what Christ did and have given to us the task of reconciling order. For God as was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, no longer counting people's sin against them. This is a wonderful message he has given to us. We are Christ's ambassador, and God is using us to speak to you. We urge you through Christ. Christ himself, we are pleading with you, be reconciled to God. Praise the name of the Lord. We are talking about, remember, sign or evidence of maturity. Now, service is a sign of maturity, you see. And the service, so your service, when we begin to take responsibility, one of the ways to know a child that's grown in the family is taking of responsibility. If everything, you just receive ministry, everything has to be done for you, your clothes has to be washed for you, food has to be cooked for you, plate has to be, bed has to be made, your teeth has to be brought for you. How can you say you have grown after you wore your trouser or wear your shirt? You say, Mommy, I've grown. You haven't grown. When you grow, the sign is that you start taking responsibility. Responsibility in the family. That's a sign of growth. The first responsibility, like we said, if a child cannot even brush his teeth, you know, wear his clothes, bathe himself, that's where to begin. The child responsibility doesn't start by, you know, cooking for you. The first thing is the body. The same thing in Romans 12, he said, in view of the mercies of God, present your body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. So that's your number one sign that you are beginning to grow. If you cannot even, you know, be able to take care of your body in terms of presenting this body holy, you cannot even present this body holy. You are not able. You still have not. You are still struggling to smoke, with smoking, you know, drinking. You are still struggling with masturbation, with a distance. That's the first place you have to conquer that those desires first of all. That's where to begin. That's where to begin the journey of maturity. To be able to tell this mouth, look, you are not going to say anything you want to say. You only have to say the things that are pleasing to the Lord. Being able to control this mouth. Control your thought that go wild. That, you, look, you cannot be thinking this thing. By controlling what you read. If you cannot even control your phone, control television you watch, control the news you listen to your ears, why then do you think, say, you are mature? And you are looking for God to give you the kingdom, give you the other one, that you are now 50 years. Nothing has happened. But you have not even begun the journey. Your personal life, you are still, you know, not able. You have to be woken up. You don't wake up by yourself. If no matter how the alarm rings, it's a problem. You haven't even been able to wake up. You cannot even, you know, be able to pray by yourself except you are told to pray or waking up to pray. It's not a sign that you are beginning. You have to master, control. First of all, put your body under subjection. If you can't conquer your body, why do you want to conquer the nation? You see, the problem is that we do not care about order. You see people trying to control every other person, but they have not controlled their own life. So the sign of maturity begins with taking responsibility for your life. To fix your life, to read the Bible, to obey the word of God, to present this your body a living sacrifice, to insist that this body must succumb to the Lord, to train this body to obey God, to train your stomach for less food. Look at the time we are in. This is a time for fasting. We have started fasting, men and brethren, in this platform to prepare for the new year. If you haven't started, please start. If you cannot train this your body to eat, you know, at the time it should eat, and not eat three times a day in this particular month, you are not matured yet. And there are certain level of, because maturity makes your muscle, you know, strengthens your muscles to carry weight. Glory of God is in weight. We have been called to inherit glory. Glory is in weight. You can't carry the 20 kilogram or 40 kilogram of weight and put on a 5 years. It will cross the chart. Some of the glory you are looking for, you don't have the muscle for it. You must show God you have grown by the things you are ready to pass through, by responsibility you are ready to take in the house, in his house, in the kingdom of God. What kind of responsibility? We have talked about this thing. Say, you shall serve the Lord your God. He'll bless your bread. How do you show service to God? You serve him with your life. You serve him with your time. You serve him with your resources. How much of your resources go into the kingdom? How much of your time go into the service of God? How much are you ready to sacrifice for the Lord? How much responsibility do you pick up by yourself? Not the things you are told to do. Yeah? Just the thing. Okay, take up that broom, then you take it up. Okay, no, give. There's need for 5 francs, give it, then you give. If there's nobody speak about it, from month to month, you don't. They are not yet matured. Maturity is for you to seek responsibility and pick it up. Serving the Lord. How do you serve the Lord? Paul said, I serve the Lord in preaching the gospel. Have you started taking responsibility in the house of God to win the souls of men? Without anybody telling you, you just know this is my responsibility. That in my workplace is God's, you know, where I've been deployed. Even though I'm paid by the government, God deployed me here. For what? To expand the kingdom. To take responsibility. To pray for that organization. To pray to change the topography. To pray to ensure that the people come to the Lord. To minister to the people. As a sign that you are beginning to grow. But it starts with a house job. In that place where you fellowship. To pick up responsibility. To sweep the fellowship ground. Pick up responsibility. To begin to sing in the choir, to pick up responsibility, to teach in the Sunday school, you know, to pick up, to visit the lost, the people who didn't come, to notice that there are people who are not here in fellowship today, to go after them. It's a sign of maturity. Nobody told you that, but it's a sign that you have grown. A grown person, you can easily know by the responsibility that they are ready to take up in the house. As long as everything is done for you, you wait until when you come late. By then the fellowship ground has been sweeped, the chair dusted, everybody. And once they say amen, bam, you are gone. The chairs, somebody has to do it, clean the environment. Is those things are not for you. You just come elegantly and sit down. And after that, you listen to the sermon to know whether pastor is anointed or not. And then you go by it, and that is it. When you go home, you close the Bible. And that is it. You will come back next Sunday. Sunday medicine, Daraprim, is a problem. You cannot, you know, so you don't say, I'm grown. The Lord is watching our response. What responsibility are you ready to? That's what determines your authority in the kingdom. I'm a man of God, apostle, I'm prophet. It's not about the title you pick up. How much responsibility? Say, he that desire to be a bishop, desire a good responsibility. In this kingdom, everything about is not position, it's not about title, it's responsibility. How much responsibility? How much people are you caring for? You're looking for God to give you 1 million rand, $1 million. For what? How much responsibility? How many people are you paying their school fees? How many missions, how many ministries are you supporting? How many pastors are you supporting? How, from month to month, for example, that you are in this plan, how much do you contribute? No, you say, thank God nobody sees me. We all log in, you log out. Nobody even know what you are doing. For example, when we call anything once in a month, We don't take to see and say, okay, sister XYZ, what happened? We didn't see your offer. Nobody's checking. Nobody's checking. Say, thank God. I like these platforms of, you know, you just vanishing, you appear, and nobody expects here. God is watching you. He is the one that you are worshiping. You say, when you serve, there must be an evidence that you, your responsibility, you are able to, ready to take. It's what determines, you see. It's what determines whether you are serving him or not. There are many scriptures you can take the rest of these things for yourself. Now, for instance, in Luke chapter 1, verse 74, say that the reason that we deliver, you know, from the hand of our enemy, so that we can serve God without fear. So that we can serve God without fear. In Luke chapter 1, 6 to 11, take care of that. You will see, you know, Zechariah serving the Lord as priest. And then we see David in the looking, serving his father, you know, his father looking after the sheep. It was in the process of looking after the sheep. What happened? That the Lord sent for him. God was watching. Was watching him in the bush, how he take care of the sheep, how that if the lion came, he went after them, he wouldn't say, oh, no, I can't take such risk. You know, after all, it's my father. And the father would have been grateful if he come and say, today, lion came and took one sheep. Hey, the father would say, thank God the lion didn't kill you. But he went after the lion and plucked the sheep from him and said, I can't go home to tell a story. I can't go home to tell a story. And God was watching. God was watching. You see, at what point did Saul get the kingdom, anointed king? He went looking for the lost sheep of his father. That's where he got he was called to be anointed as king. So your service, what is your service like? Are you still, is this still all about you? About your prayers, about you, your everything is me and my family. That's the what we teach people that are in kindergarten. God bless me, bless my father, and bless my mother, and bless me. The whole world is finished once they pray that prayer. You see, so you're soul winning. You know, how many people can you point to as the people you brought in this kingdom? That's the value. The reason you are left. When you gave your life to Christ, you didn't die that day, because that day you qualify to go to heaven. The reason you are left is for the minister. Your salvation came with a ministry. How many souls have you brought into the kingdom of God? How many have you even brought and said, come to this midnight prayer and listen? It's going to improve your life. How many people have you been able to connect? You see, so that's a sign, you know, of maturity. You can even see a mature person by the way they pray. Did you see that? The things you ask in prayer give you away. Look at Psalm 2, verse 7 to 8, quickly. Our time is running out quickly. Hurry up. Yes, I'll declare of the decree. This day, the Lord has said to me, you are my son, today I've begotten you. Verse 8. Ask of me, and I'll give you nation for inheritance, and the end of the earth for your possession. You know, it is very easy to know who is who by the things we ask. When we say, let us pray, or we said, give your prayer request, or write it down. Let me tell you, most of the time, 90% of God's people, check what is in the list of their prayer points. You hardly where you see somebody saying, oh, I want to grow in the Lord. My life is not conforming to the image of Christ. Please, I want you to pray for me. My life is not conforming to the image of Christ. I've not begun to have victory over my tongue. I really want to know him. I want to, you know, change. I want to begin to win. So these things are not what is. Check it if you think it's a joke. Check your prayer point. It is about, I need a job. I need a house. I need this. I need that. I need this. The enemy is oppressing. This and that and that. So what? We are not asking. We are asking for things. Look at it. Sons ask for nations. They ask for souls of men. Lord, give me the people of East London. Give me people of this school. Give me this staff that I want them to serve the Lord. And that is what you are fasting for. Check the things we fast for, beloved, and check. Are you fasting for your life to be transformed? Are you fasting for the life of your children to be transformed? Yes, maybe sometimes you may fast about that because at least they are giving you enough headache to cause you to fast. You know? Some don't even fast in that dimension. They give it up and said, well, that's your business. If you don't want to repent, it's up to you. You have given birth to them physically. You need to give birth to them spiritually. And when you were giving birth to them physically, it was not easy. You can attest to that. It was a labor. Blood was coming out. You were crying. The same thing. Spiritual birth is more serious than the physical one. So you have to labor. It should cost you some sleep, cost you some food. You are laboring for them, including that neighbor that is giving you hassles. God is waiting for you to bathe them in him. So we are talking about that even the issue of your prayer give you away. So we have seen that maturity is a mature children is the one that is entitled. And the next, subtopic when it comes to the condition, the price. The price is knowledge of God and his word. You know, we have read that in Acts chapter 20, verse 32, quickly. Acts 20, 32, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace that is able to, build you up and give you an inheritance among them that are sanctified. Beloved, the knowledge of God and his word is one of the things that make you to become, eligible and the price you have to pay. Because the inheritance you don't know, you cannot possess. The knowledge of God, revelational knowledge of God. And so if you are true unto the word of God, sorry, you will not be able. And when we say knowledge of the word, I'm not talking about head knowledge. You know it. By his stripes, I'm healed. No. That's not what I'm talking about. What I'm talking about revelational knowledge. That comes as you meditate on the word. You pray into the word. You sit on that word until you say, Lord, open this verse to me. Open this scripture to me. I need understanding. That's how to, the extent to which you know is the extent that you will receive. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. According as his divine power has given to us all that pertain to life and godliness, but it comes through the knowledge of him that has called you to glory and virtue. Through the knowledge of God, seeking the knowledge of God to grow in our knowledge of God. Then the next one is seed to parents. Seed to your parents provoke access to inheritance. Let me tell you, the word of God cannot be broken. Seed to your parents, physical parents, spiritual parents, give you access to your inheritance. Ask Esau what happened and he will tell you. You remember, Esau is the first son who is eligible to double portion of inheritance and it is his own. And then after that, his brother, what is left will be given to his brother. But you see, time was going and his life remained the way it is until one day the father called him and said, my son. And that's Genesis chapter 20, 27. You know, the father called him when Isaac was old and almost blind. Can you see that? He called his son, his elder son, and said, my son, yes, father, Esau replied, I'm old now. Isaac said, and I expect every day to be my last day. Eh? And you are watching me. You think your inheritance comes to you automatically. There's something you do to activate it. Praying alone to the father does not make your inheritance come to you. There are certain things you must do to make it, to activate it being released. He said, I'm old. Take your bow and a quiver full of arrow out into the open field and hunt some wild game for me. Prepare it just the way I like it. I like it so it's savory and good. And bring it here for me to eat. Then I will pronounce the blessing that belongs to you, my first son, before I die. Let me read King James. He said, and make me a sovereign man, such as I love, and bring it that I may eat that my soul will bless you. Aye. There's something we don't understand. There's a difference between God bless you and somebody's soul blessing you. Note that. I want to go and read the book of Philippians. Paul was praying, pray for Ephesians, pray for Colossians, pray for Philippians. Go and I want to go back. Just take time and study. Do you know when Paul was writing to the Philistines, he said, I get excited when I'm praying for you the way I don't get over other people. Then you keep wondering what happened. He said, because you have people are the one that partner with me in the gospel. You are not just receiving the revelation and this thing, unction and say, thank God for the unction in the life of Paul. You give, you sow into my life to partner with me time and again, even when I'm not in your church, even when I'm not in your city, in your territory. Time and again, you are the one that partner with me. You keep sending to me without me asking for it. He said, so go and read and see. That's where that promise you claim. But my God shall supply all your need according to his riches. And I claim it. I claim it. It doesn't come by claiming. There is an underlying action that makes that scripture activated. These are truths that the Lord revealed to me early in life. And that's why I live the way I live. The truth is, I respond to the issue of being able to minister to my physical parents. We are five in number. I'm the last born. I make sure me and my husband, when he was alive, we take ownership as though my parents we had an only child, and that is me and my husband. We didn't, there's usually a competition. My sisters, we said, but the other person, has he given? The other person, I don't care about who I've given. I keep doing as though I'm the only child you get back to. I'm doing it in the light of the word of God, ministering to my parents physically. The same thing I do to my spiritual parents. Anyone that minister to me, whether it is one day he minister or they come into a fellowship and minister, I don't let them go that way. I have to invest into their life because I know this principle. I'm activating an inheritance. So I don't need preaching. I don't need to be seen. I don't need to be moved. I don't need to be told. The Lord taught me these things early in life, and I practice them. If you want to see God and to see activation, you can pray till you are blue and red. As long as you don't operate the covenant will not work for you. You will be eating like, praying like elephant and getting reward like a rat. Because everything doesn't go on talk. Talk is cheap. It is your actions. Ministering. Look at that. This is his father. He's entitled to it. The father said, look, go and get me something to eat so that my soul will bless you. My soul will bless you. And can I tell you? His wife heard it and told it, his younger son. The one that brought the inheritance, that brought the sovereign meat, received the blessing. The one that responded first, receive the blessing. We are talking about seed. Look at it in Proverbs chapter 3, verse number 8 to 9. He said, look at that. He started by saying, trust in the Lord with all your heart from verse number 5. Don't lean on your own understanding. In all thy ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. And he went further to say to you, and that is Proverbs. If you find it, you before me, you read. Our time is up. Blessed be the name of the Lord. He said, yeah, seek his will in all you do, and then he will direct your path. Don't be impressed with your own wisdom. Instead, fear the Lord and turn away from evil. Then you will gain a renewed health and vitality. Honor the Lord with your wealth and with the best part of everything you have, your land produce, then he will fill your barn with grain and your vats with overflowing with the finest wheat. He said, look at that. So you see, he said, honor the Lord with your substance, with the first fruit of your increase. He said, honor the Lord. Give in to the Lord. Give in to the Lord. The things he said, the one that belong to him, because the one that belong to him is not even your own. The one that belongs to you. Some of us are master in disbursing what belongs to the Lord that's in our hand. Perhaps your tithe, you disburse it. Your tithe is not your own. So even when you give it, if you, whoever you like, that you give it to. Maybe you give it to the poor or you put it in the ministry. You haven't given anything. That thing belongs to God. It's not your own. It's like taking what belongs to another and giving. That's not your giving. It's not your giving. After you've given your tithe, what counts your giving is what you give after you have given your tithe. That's what your giving life. What you give to God after you've given your tithe. What you give to men after you've given your tithe. In the hierarchy of the people that are your spiritual mentors, people that you are receiving from, at one way or the other, what you give to them is what measure your giving. What you give to the poor is what measures your giving. That giving must come in that order. God is a God of order. When even the doing good, he said it in Galatians, do good to all men, especially those that are in the household of faith. I see a situation where people can even give to unbelievers. They try to reach out to unbelievers. They do soup kitchen for them. They do one thing for the unbelievers. But believers are dying in their face, but they don't care about them. The ministry, order of ministry, minister to the Lord, minister to the saints, and minister to the world. If you miss that order, it's not accepted. So you must invest in the life of your parents. How do we invest? Ephesians 6:1. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother. Two parents, the one in the Lord and the one in the world. The one in the world, you must obey them as long as what they demand from you does not contradict the word of God, including the one in the Lord. If I teach you anything that's contrary to the word of God, you are not supposed to obey me. The authority I have is only the authority of scriptures. If the scripture is not with me, you have no right to obey me. Sowing into their life is very, very key. It's very, very key. And that is what provoked the blessings of God. Galatians, we have talked about 6 from verse 6 to 10. You read it for yourself. Philippians chapter 4, verse 16 to 19. You read it for yourself. You read 1 Kings 17, 1 to 24, and see what happened, even to the widow of Zarephath. Ministering to them, causes activation of what belongs to you to come to you, even without much prayer. Obedience to them, doing what they ask you to do, that does not contradict the word of God, brings you to that blessing. And with this men and brethren, we draw the curtain for now. And so we are talking about the price for inheritance. So while you are claiming, check to see whether your life has met these conditions. Let us pray. Thank you, Jesus. Talk to the Lord by yourself. We will have a whole 1 hour to pray into it on Monday. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Your word is life. Thank you, Jesus. Your word is life. Blessed God be your name. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray with thanksgiving. Amen. All right, I hand over. Who is the one that is coordinating for the communion? And then please take us to the communion and dismiss God's people with God's blessing, provided they remember the fasting has begun. Okay.
All right. Thank you so much, Mama. Let God continue to bless you for all the effort and the blessing of your word. In the name of Jesus Christ Nazareth, may we please pick our element quickly. I'm just going to read these verses and then we will take them. John chapter 6, and then we will take the communion. I'm just reading it as a reminder of the words that you have just received. So loaded, and I pray that the Lord will give us all the understanding required. John chapter 6, I read from verse 47. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me has everlasting life. I am that bread of life. Your fathers did eat manna in the wilderness and are dead. This is the bread which cometh down from heaven, that a man may eat thereof and not die. I am the living bread, underline that, which came down from heaven. If any man eats of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, underline that, which I will give for the life of the world. The Jews therefore spoke among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? Then Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, except ye eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, ye have no life in you. Whoso eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood hath eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is meat indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He that eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood dwelleth in me, and I in him. As the living Father has sent me, and I live by the Father, so he that eateth me, even he shall live by me. In just one sentence, everything that we have read about in this passage, that's exactly what we have just received. The word himself. We have just received the bread. We have just received the blood packaged in the word and in the communion. That is exactly what he has given. So which means whatever God drops into your spirit, into your life, through the word that we just had, you can appropriate it. That is, if you so desire any area, they ask, you have seen a gap in your spiritual life. You have seen the world have just given you a mirror to see yourself. And now you have seen one spot or one wrinkle in one area of your face. And now you want that wrinkle to go away as you are taking the communion. Jesus says, it is the same thing that you are taking. And so, if whatever that is in the world you have received, which you want to be appropriated in your life, as you are taking the communion, you can receive that same help that you so desire. And as we have asked, the choice is in our hands. May we take the bread, take the liquid, and let us pray. Father, we want to thank you. We want to worship you, for indeed, no one is like you, Father. Thank you. You provided yourself for us as a sacrifice. A sacrifice, O God, the ransom for our soul. You provided yourself as the propitiation for our sins. The sacrifice. That Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of man. That Lamb that is without blemish, which Lord, the high priest, offered as the token of salvation for Israel. And the word of God says that every time the blood of that Lamb is upon the mercy seat, heaven comes down, O God, upon Israel. There is restoration. And at least for the next 1 year, the mercy of God overflows over Israel. The blessings of God overflow over the people. The glory of God takes over for the next 1 year. Until the next year again, the high priest pours the same blood on the mercy seat. And today, Father, that blood was offered once and for all, so that your mercy can continue to overflow from eternity to eternity. We ask right now grace to respond to you, because, oh God, anyone who responds to you, you said that person will live forever. Thank you as you partake in your flesh and your blood. Let it be so for every man, every woman this morning. I ask in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Let's partake and I hand over.
Amen. Thank you so much, Pastor Dean. Thank you so much to Mipulani for the entry prayer. And of course, Mama Heart for the teaching of today. Very sobering to have to look at yourself in the mirror and see where you are at. May the Holy Spirit help us to continue to do that as we continue to pursue our relationship with our God. Amen. Beloved, as Mama said, fasting has started in preparation of next year. Thank you very much for everyone who has contacted me regarding the seed for the conference, because there is no conference registration fee. So we are trusting that each one of us will put our hands together and we will get the conference, all the resources that we need, as God would give us the grace. We saw that that was one of the measuring sticks of our maturity and our growth in Christ. Amen. So please let us continue to get our resources together for the conference. If you have missed the banking details, please feel free to contact me or anyone of the team so that we can assist you. Amen. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Well done, beloved, for staying awake. We praise the Lord. Let's see if you are awake. Let us unmute. And then let us share the grace together. Amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit, rest and abide with each one of us, now and forevermore. Surely God's goodness and mercy
shall follow us all the days of our lives, and shall be
last
as well as
our
Lord,
peace forever and ever. Amen. Blessings, beloved. See you at midnight, at midday, and in midnight. Amen. Amen.
Thank you so much. Shalom, shalom, sis.
Shalom.
Shalom.
Shalom. Shalom.
Shalom. Shalom.